Welcome to both the class and Wednesday public speaker series, Experiment and Exploration, the Bay Area Experimental Media Arts Underground. And the class meets Mondays and Wednesdays. And I just, for people in the class, as I said, I'd love for you to get into the habit of inhabiting these seats down front. The place is so big that it's often much more intimate if you come down and sit closer to the podium. So I encourage you to come and sit closer. So today is the first of the public speaker series, and before I get into it, I just want to let people know that next Wednesday, the pioneering experimental filmmaker Barbara Hammer will be coming via Skype to talk about her work. And she is one of the major Bay Area figures in the LGBTQT experimental film movement beginning in the 1960s and 70s. So it'll be a wonderful experience to see some of her work and talk about the impact of gay and lesbian filmmaking, both on the Bay Area and on film history in general. On February 7th, the composer and UC professor Ken Uno, who is an experimental composer and vocalist, will come and talk about his work and some of the traditions of experimental music in the Bay Area. On February 14th is the video artist Chip Lord, who is another pioneer in Bay Area video art and the emergence of video as a medium, a creative medium. And later in the semester in March, the light artist Jim Campbell will be here to talk about his work and his commission, which is going to be on the top of the Salesforce building in San Francisco. So it will become one of the most seen artworks probably in the history of the Bay Area. Lynn Hirschman Leeson, also a pioneering new media artist and feminist artist, will be here in March. And the series will continue into April. So it's a very exciting list of Wednesday speakers. But to kick off the speaker series today, I couldn't think of a more appropriate figure in the firmament of luminous Bay Area media artists than the filmmaker and impresario Craig Baldwin. Craig has been an instigator, provocateur, and driving force in the San Francisco alternative arts community for over 30 years. Craig's other cinema and basement film archive at Artist Television Access on Valencia Street, and this is one of the premier media alternative spaces that still exists in San Francisco's Mission, has been part of the Bay Area's ongoing cinematic revolution, turning generations of young filmmakers and artists onto the ecstasies of creative and handmade filmmaking. For decades, his weekly high-octane screenings to sell-out audiences at the Other Cinema feature an eclectic range of no-budget, artist-made films. You can call them underground, personal, poetic, queer, surrealist, feminist, structural, punk films, found films, love films, and smash-the-state films that have come from all over the world. And on Saturday nights, you can be there and have an amazing cinematic experience. In addition to the exhibition program, Craig's created the Other Cinema Zine, which is an online film journal, and we'll talk about how to get to the Other Cinema Journal, online journal, at another moment. And it's a place that gives filmmakers and scholars a platform to write on alternative and experimental film. There's also a component that sells DVDs called OCD, Other Cinema DVDs, which sells not only his own films, but collections of important underground works from all over. And there's the entire collection is in the Media Resource Center here at Berkeley. So that's another place for you to explore. The Other Cinema is the essence of the open and outlandish and counterculture that has made San Francisco what it is, and sadly is always on the verge of being snuffed out by rising rents and cuts in nonprofit arts funding in the Bay Area. But somehow Craig manages to continue despite this flood of gentrification that's wiping out much of the alternative art scene. As a filmmaker, Craig Baldwin is recognized to be among the most important experimental filmmakers working today, working primarily with found and discarded filmic materials. His films have been acknowledged by audiences, curators, critics internationally as seminal contributions to postmodern cinema and have pushed the cinema of appropriation into new areas of possibility. We'll be looking at one of Craig's films later in the semester, Sonic Outlaws, which has to do with copyright and appropriation. Not since Bruce Conner's films from the 1960s has there been such a productive rethinking of the collage film that turns the garbage of outmoded media culture into socially engaged art, critiquing the horrors of the culture industry, tech industry, and the military industry, and any other industry you can think of. Baldwin's films are nearly unique in the way they're intellectually rigorous and as they are accessible. He's one of the few filmmakers whose films are equally engaging in contexts that range from the Museum of Modern Art to Mission District punk rock clubs. So he's going to talk about the history of this alternative scene that he's so deeply a part of. And so let's welcome Craig Baldwin.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Jeffrey. I'm not going to be able to live up to that. I'm very honored to be here. This is my first time in this particular location. I've had some shows over there, the older PFA. I don't want to, rant, but I'm apologizing ahead of time. It might come to that because I have a lot to say and a lot of clips to show. So I'm just letting you know right now, there's many, name dropping wouldn't quite be the word, but I'm going to try to almost a kind of a list of the places that are what would you call it, precarious or dying or gone. And that's really primarily my reason for my presence here. I am a filmmaker, and you can see my film later, as Jeffrey said, but I'm really here in the very short amount of time we have, I'm wasting it right now, is to kind of talk about the context, you understand, the kind of the history. You might not know because you may be younger than me, and I know it because I lived through it, so I'm sharing my experience with you, for what it's worth. And it is worth something, by the way. If you're taking this class, it really strikes at the whole raison, the reason for this class, which is experimental and alternative ways of community building and expression. So it's going to go kind of like this. I'm going to talk a little bit about myself, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the kind of archival work I do, and then I'm going to kind of spin out into the large other community spaces, not just mine, and talk about the history of those, mostly in San Francisco, by the way. And then we're going to show a lot of a few examples of what I would call social practice. It's kind of emerging of community consciousness raising and performance art. And that'll be at the tail. So I hope that we get to that. So I don't want to waste too much time because I do want to leave some time for a Q&A. There will be about five videos interspersed in the midst of my talk. So I just apologize again ahead of time that if there's a slight snafu, we could, we're just making this up. This is like experimental for sure. And so I like the idea of show and tell kind of thing. So I'll talk for a sec. we'll show something, it will be a clip. These things, we're not going to show a whole movie, you know, Rashomon or something. That would be great, you could really kick back. But no, it's going to be just a clip that I selected for you guys. And then you can talk about that Q&A in your seminars and, you know, and so on later. Okay, so let's just start by, and by the way, I brought the long pair of glasses today, so I can hardly read my own notes. But that's okay, I'll take care of that. So anyway, what I'm saying is that I kind of ended up at ATA Gallery, as Jeffrey said. It's probably the last. There's three or four others, the lab. I'll name these guys later, that exist. It's really a kind of, this is the context of the whole thing, is pretty contested, especially in the mission, as a destination you know. It has a lot to do with technology and new industry in the Bay Area. It's almost something, it's almost too big to stop, frankly. But through art, you know, we can hopefully make some interventions. Shows at ATA, they needed a programmer, really. What it came down to, it was kind of the idea of a live workspace. And this it's embedded in the idea of the live workspace is this fusion of art and life. So I didn't really, not only could I not afford both a studio and a crib, a bed, but the idea is that having them together in the same space makes sense for someone who wants to live the artist's life and not have to get on a bus or on a bike and go all the way over to your studio and then work there. So this live work idea is kind of embodied. It kind of has the name a little bit corrupted now, especially in the South Mark, if you know about that. It means a lot of things like architect, not to put architects down, but it's less about the idea of communal cooperative living combined with a gallery that's open to the public. So I became sort of the curator there. My first series was called The Rad, The Mad, and The Bad, which was radical films, which we're going to be talking about, that is a politically advanced, will be argumentative, and the Mad, which kind of meant, I guess you could say, auteur films, you know, think Fellini or Pasolini or something, and then The Bad, which was basically cult films, exploitation, so on and so forth. We do less of that now. We were a little more of a populist thing back then, and that would draw. We would do midnight movies, you know, believe it or not. That was kind of the bad part of it. Well, thank God there's other theaters now in the Mission, as you may know, the Roxy and the Little Roxy, and now there's the Alamo. So we don't have to worry so much about those features. You understand? What we do is we show shorts. And that's the idea, again, of this idea of kind of reflecting the multiplicity, let's say, of our community. It's not just to, kick back and just check one off from some distributor, but rather get artists together and, talk about a theme, really, and then they'll cross-talk about the theme, and there's a so-called intertextuality between one thing and another. They may be looking at a theme, bicycling, tattoos, whatever, but the point is that through this refracted, is what I call it, you know, lens, many different angles are presented. So that's kind of the model for the curating there. I wish I had my calendar. It doesn't, I mean, it's right there, it's my head. Now, I don't have a hard copy, but it will be in 10 days, more sweat. For 10 days of grinding out those blurbs, very hard. So I hope you do see it sooner or later. I'm sure Jeffrey will bring a copy in, and we also have, of course, online. You can check out other cinema online. Well, all you'll see now is dark, because again, during the winter and also during the summer, where there's a period in which we have to prepare for the next season, of course. So it's coming up February 17th. And not to blow my horn on that, but just so you know, that's definitely a destination for you guys if you want to go over to the Mission, 24th Street, Marsop. In fact, if you come in and you identify yourself as someone in this class, I'll probably let you in for free or buy you a beer or something like that. So there you go. That's just an incentive. Now, what Jeffrey said about other zine is also true. You can go there. It's a little bit of a mess right now. It was kind of a natural thing, and I'm not just speaking for myself, but someone who is curating, you know, working pretty hard at it, and being in a community of artists, and that there would be a place where maybe other people could share and trade and exchange ideas. So that's what it is—a platform. It's not fancy, but it's a website, and there's, I don't know, like 33 issues of it. See, so if you want to go out and read those articles, more power to you. You know, you scan through them, and I do believe they're all archived. The only problem now is, just a caveat, is that, again, same thing. We're between seasons right now. So the thing is, a new issue, which is 33, won't be up. You might have a hard time getting into it. So just wait a month. I'm working on that every day, I promise you. Now, finally, what Jeffrey says, the OCD. Yes, it's true that, again, you're in a community of artists, and you're just so rich. And you say, well, God, we show it here, and that's fantastic. But wow, what about, you know, let's people in Europe see this, South America, and so on and so forth. So, ideas, time has come. Well, it's gone now. DVD is totally bomb, in case you didn't know, but I love them. I love VHS, and you're seeing some today. This anticipates my theory of media archaeology, but I'll get to that in a second. So the thing is, I and some other people did go that route and formed this company, the Cinema Digital, or DVD, as you wish, and they produced about 20. So though it's true they're around, and like I say, I'm so honored that UCB would have them available. I'm very proud to have those, and the nature of them is the same thing I've been talking about, which is group shows, the idea of shorts. You know, we're not necessarily putting down features, I'm just saying that's not our purview. We're interested in community artists or emerging, our local, our emphasis are in the local and the regional, and to bring people together. We also this idea of embodiment. Now, you don't get it with the DVD, no. That's what you get with the microcinema. I'm really kind of putting it forward as a way of sharing art that's not necessarily virtual. You're going to see something, if we get to it later, about this problem with the so-called virtual self. But here, I'm a hypocrite because, you know, I'm online and all that. So what I'm saying is we already prioritize, you know, the artist being there in person and having an exchange with the audience and his or her artwork, see? Kind of a triangulation. So that's a key, and that's what separates us from let's say, like the movie theater, where you go in and you have to buy popcorn, it's ridiculously expensive, and so on and so forth. It's more of a salon, the idea of a salon. I could go into the whole history of that, but I've taught here, by the way, couple of years ago, and you know, this would have been a whole class about the history of micro cinemas and salons, but I'm afraid we're not going to go into that right now. I'm just saying that it's part of that history that I'll go into a little later. So now we have set up this idea of me in this communal household, and it is, you know, booking these shows, three shows a week, and trying to establish a kind of not just decorative art making, by the way, or design, which is taking over. That might be a bad word here. A lot of art departments around, but actually something that's more engaged, you know, more with a little bit more historical consciousness. Now that is a pretty tall order, and I don't necessarily expect my students or all the people who show it at other cinema to have historical consciousness. But hey, if you ask me, that's what I like to get to, because I think this history is really being erased, and one way to keep it is, again, through this kind of what I would call archival project of mine. We'll get to that in a second. Jeffrey mentioned to it has to do with 16mm films. Again, erased, gone. Why? Who is it? Somebody fault? Well, it's really kind of a larger, almost a larger movement that I could solve. I'm surfing the wave of obsolescence. That's kind of my response to it. And as media, the things you got, devices you got in front of you right now will probably be totally useless in 5 years, in case you didn't know. And you're going to have to buy another $800 dealio. And you know, I mean, I kind of feel a little enraged by that, to be honest with you. So what I'm saying is that I kind of don't look towards technology to solve problems, and we are really more interested in, again, these historical artifacts. So we have this archive, and we share it. We make it available. We share shots with other makers who are making a certain kind of film. like these films I've been talking about, sometimes called collage essays or collage narratives for that matter, compilation docs. Many people that you might know or you will know or you'll see right here. That's I think a tremendous contribution that I can claim. Now the thing is, so you get this kind of setting up for my Doug. We're going to talk to Doug about 11 times where you can see this is actually 3D. So please put your 3D glasses on now. Oh, you didn't care. Sorry. This is a 3D movie that shows where I live. ATA. New ATA is made by Brian Boyce.
Scientific fiction.
Project.
Electromagnetism.
Project thoughts.
Electromagnetism is life.
Project thoughts into the brains of humans living on the surface above.
Say Brian Boyce, fantastic maker. Exactly what I'm talking about, or will talk about. In this case, it's a kind of a documentary. Generally working with found footage, but again, on the point, looking in the right direction, and to kind of make a documentary about this alternative space, and not only that, all the sounds and the images on the wall are. Happened to be from my film. So I'm really honored that Brian put that together. But anyway, so we're coming up with the next thing pretty soon, Doug. And that is this this idea of set up the kind of antagonist, or protagonist, anti-hero position of these marginalized little beatniks. And there's an historical kind of notion that I'd like to put in front of you. We'll see one part of it now, and we'll see a later part of it later, okay, if we get to that. And this is the idea, and I don't want to, again, drop a bunch of names, but it's going to be on the test, Jeffrey told me. You got to really get the idea of this, the situationist. And the situationist there was a lot of situationist activity here, by the way, at UCB. Point Blank was named one group. Tom Ward was a guy, I think, taught here. The point is that in the post-war years, in, let's say, late 50s and early 60s, not to take you too far back, there were a group of people who theorized about the takeover of everyday life by what would they call a spectacle. That's about as deep as I can get into it right now. The idea that there's a sector of society, so they say, which concentrates all looking and all consciousness. And they, I think, were thinking probably a little bit more about the media and about cinema and the big screen then, like I say, 50, 60 years ago. Now I think, as I told you before, it might have a little bit, the California version is a little bit displaced into, again, this... whatever you call it, a slave to the device kind of thing. But it's the same thing through this idea that there's a special relation between people, not direct, but mediated, like I say, through this larger idea that looms above us, that there's some kind of consensus, or that celebrities rule the world, or we always have to, there's a unification where there is none, the large gestures like football games or something is really something we all agree on and unite us as a country or as a people. And, that's a very gross kind of a gloss on the idea of situations. But I'm just producing that idea to you now. I think you'll probably come across it again. It's in practically every article, critical article you'll read in our journal today, the idea of situations, this critique against this centralization of looking at a big spectacle. So I'm going to show you, in fact, about 2 minutes from the original film. It's very difficult to see because it's going to be subtitled, I'm sorry to say. It's just to give you a taste. Go ahead, Daniel.
Dans le monde de l'image autonomisée, où le mensonger s'est menti à lui-même. Le spectacle en général, comme inversion concrète de la vie, est le mouvement autonome du non-vivant. Le spectacle se présente à la fois comme la société même, comme une partie de la société et comme instrument d'unification. En tant que partie de la société, il est le secteur qui concentre tout regard et toute conscience. Du fait même que ce secteur est séparé, il est le lieu du regard abusé de la fausse conscience. Et l'unification qu'il accomplit n'est rien d'autre qu'un langage officiel de la séparation généralisée.
Et nous avons, à la fin de ces délibérations, apprécié ce qui était positif et mis en évidence aussi qu'il restait encore beaucoup à faire.
Le spectacle n'est pas un ensemble d'images, mais un rapport social entre des personnes, médiatisé par des images. Le spectacle, compris dans sa totalité, est...
Thank you. So, again, I shouldn't apologize, but I don't really expect you to have an easy time with that. And by the way, it's an hour and a half long. It's very dense, and you have to, of course, read the subtitles. There's a version now where it's been dubbed, and it's easier. You see that it's a compilation. That's what I'm talking about. It's great. It's an essay, agree with it or not, a philosophical essay, that was first a book, but then a film was made out of it. And then so, you know, it's kind of a think piece. And I'm just saying that it's worthy of thinking about these ideas. I'm trying to represent them to you now. And it kind of, like, it frames everything I will say all day long. So anyway, the ideas of the situations worked their way into OC programming, see, again, through, it was a moment, or whatever you call it, the sensibility of the times. I'm talking about 70s and 80s and 90s and so on. That's what I'm going to be talking about. So the thing is, many of the categories in the shows we have in other cinema are drawn from the idea of situations, like psychogeography, you know, the idea that a landscape could have a certain sensibility, a certain consciousness. We also have media archaeologies, I mentioned a little earlier. This idea that there's something to be learned and not just throwaway culture of instant obsolescence, but going back not only at the content, but also in the form and understanding what television made possible, radio made possible, and what even 3D, made possible. Class on 3D, and so that would be pretty progressive here at UC Berkeley, and so on and so forth. So those I'm just saying that those are the those are the ideas that kind of I absorbed and we give back to the community. In the meantime, again, I'm not going to whine. I'm going to try to get off my own self right now. But I developed this idea of this kind of precarious existence. That's what that's this that's the truth. Frankly, and so many of our neighbors have gone down, and but we kind of on the I call it masochism of the margins. And so by being marginalized, you kind of have to you have to take a lot of you have to have patience, and you have to be able to endure. And so again, this sounds like whining, but it's a central theme really in my work is this kind of antagonism, counter, and defending, constantly defending yourself in the present moment, especially in the larger cities, of course. So this idea, just is one of many neologisms, masking the margins, and then a cinema povero, which is taken from the art povero movement. This is something if you're art students, you would know. Art povero, just very briefly, started in Italy and was after the Second World War. And of course, we got just as many artists back for the war as before the war. But what are they going to do? What are they going to take after that atrocity, the catastrophe in Europe? They're going to take a slab of marble and chip away and make some nude torso or something. I mean, is that going to be really the art when these people don't have any place to live? So anyway, not not to rant on you, but I'm telling you what art pauvre is, which means impoverished art. And so the people, not only in Italy, of course, it grew, would be using the material that was available to them at the time, which is not marble, but was rebar, concrete, brick, whatever, chicken wire, whatever was around the new buildings that were coming up, you know, for all the displaced people. And we take those things. Now it means a lot more. It just needs this idea of being creative, inventive, and using the materials at hand, availableism, as I said. So anyway, this idea of cinema povero, making something out of nothing, redeeming from dross to gold, is really deeply ingrained in my practice and also in the works we show. Call it availableism, as I said, you know, working with what you have from where you are, and then a new kind. Sometimes liabilities can be assets. You understand, because you have to be creative. It's a challenge to you to do what you can and not just order this block of marble from northern Italy, come down to Naples and do repeat something that was done 5 centuries ago. So that's why you see the trace of the media in the works that I show. It's kind of the part of it. It's not a transparent window, but it actually shows, we're interested in the grain, the glitches, the effect of video, the effect of film. We're going to see in a second. All right, so anyway, I call it a folk archive, and I like this idea. And the archiving movement is huge, by the way. And again, I'm not going to go down that road, but that would be another class. You can't read an art journal these days with the idea of the archive coming up. It's there, and by the way, it's in all your hands, in your back pockets, right there. You can just see, and it's never going away because of technology. I mean, you could argue it never did go away, but the thing is, it's certainly here now. And everything you wrote and everything you saw, not everything, of course, but it's going to be checkerboarded with the present, you understand? So that's something, that's a kind of radical idea. It really comes from Rick Prelinger, and I'm gonna acknowledge him right now. He is involved with the Internet Archive, which I'm just nodding to right now. Acknowledging is a fantastic place to go and know about, and where you can get much bigger than my own archive, material online. That's not only, make it very brief, of course, text, but also music, and then, of course, films is what Rick has from the middle part of the 20th century. And then they got a Wayback Machine, okay? Does anyone, too big of a class to ask, but a Wayback Machine would, you know what the average life of a web page is? Not that I really know, but I can get pretty close to it. I think it's about 40 days or something like that. It's probably less than that now. So in other words, all the web pages you visited in your life will, what happened to them, So they actually have this idea whose time's come, to actually preserve every web page, you understand? If you can grok that, every web page, you can go back and you can see let's name some of you, UCB's web page looked like, whatever, 1990 is probably the first one or something like that. I mean, that's not too shabby. That's a really great project. So hats off to Internet Archive, Rick Prelinger, who has this idea of this checkerboarding idea of the present and the past. We're living that way, and we're not trying to dismiss the past and dismiss history. We're calling for a kind of a radical historical consciousness, in fact. So anyway, that media archaeology, media ecology, understanding where microcinemas fit in the larger thing, that's what we're doing right now, by the way. And this idea of a detournement. Now here's another idea, again, we're kind of finishing up with my thing now, but another idea that comes from the situationist. You see in the word detournement, it's not up there. I could write it up there. Detour. So the idea is, oh, that's fine. That's fantastic. Great. Thanks, Doug. Yeah, okay. I hope detournement is, I know it is. So again, do you think we have the time to go through all those? No, I'm giving you a very short version of that right now. And by the way, that's in 3D. So bring your 3D glasses back up now. So the thing is, that's my manifesto. or from orphan. That's kind of what I've been talking about. It's this idea of taking orphans. Orphan film is a film that doesn't have a mom and dad. It doesn't have a producer anymore. That guy's dead. It doesn't have an institution to shepherd it into safe keeping. You know where it goes? Into the dumpster, in case you didn't know. And not me, but friends of mine, we're in the dumpster here. With about 500 of the films were thrown out by the UC Extension, which is right there next to the bar station, in case you didn't know. Oh, probably not now. Where I used to rent films, you understand? I used to come over to, because it was part of UC, a nonprofit, get good documentaries, take the BART over, rent a film, take it back to San Francisco, if you can believe it. And then 5 years later, not funny, they're throwing those films away. So my peeps rescued them, don't you see? That's a brilliant and glorious and heroic move. And then, you know, distributed them, so on and so forth. So that's what, those are orphan films. There's no one that's going to take care of them. But when I rescue them, we morph them, we change them, we make them something else. So that's what, we'll just keep that out. You don't have to, try to absorb all that. But I'm saying it now anyway. And so the idea is that this idea of detour, to take something that had another intention and turn it to a new purpose, to repurpose, to, remix. You know, you've heard it a million times. And so this is kind of this establishing this other kind of alternative culture, which is below or to the side of the official culture, film industry, and you're trying to talk back in a way, in a kind of a critical way, certainly a funny way, oftentimes parody and satire. So opening up this space for electronic folk culture, as I call it, that you'll see in the Sonic Outlaws, by the way, and a larger public domain, a larger cultural commons. It has happened. Sonic, as you'll see, does have to do, I'm not taking it up now, the idea of the intellectual property. But it's the same thing, how, despite all the fact that these films are being thrown away, or books for that matter, that's what the Internet Archive does, digitize books, like mad, like right now. Just imagine. And next year it's going to be 10 times more people, or machines, digitizing books, because there's no space for the books anymore in the libraries. And it's a problem, in case you didn't know, I'm telling you. So, This idea of the keeping that stuff in the public domain, rather than letting a bunch of what would be the word, cynical and bad faith claims about intellectual property, especially when the people are dead. Now they're trying to extend it to like 75 years. You know what I mean? In other words, like the Disney Corporation. You can't use Mickey Mouse and so on. This is an anecdote, but they just, when the Mickey Mouse thing, Steamboat Willie, was going to go out to public domain, by the way, guess what passed? in Congress, an extension of the copyright law so that someone could touch it again for another 25 years. It just goes on and on and on, rather than the other way, and all the way that technology would point, which is towards sharing. In fact, we have this more of an enclosure of privatization of our common shared culture. So our response is to jam it, the culture jam. We have one right here. So Mr. Doug, please, let's see Hollywood Bird.
To the people of the earth, I command that you obey the following orders. You will place the
videotape
under our absolute control and be governed as our colony.
There is no freedom without the law.
Whose law, Moses? Yours? We will not live by your copyright commandments. We're free.
Those who will not live by the law shall die by the law.
Piracy
side, let him come to me.
If you're looking for trouble, you came to the right place.
My daddy was a green eyed mountain jack because of evil. My middle name is
Piracy.
Oh, don't you mess
Presley.
Elvis.
Save the melodramatics for your acting classes.
I don't care what
Moses
says. He's an asshole.
You know what I think? I think you ain't nothing but egg-sucking gutter trash.
No. Truce, you guys. Listen, we got a higher purpose here, right? A wake-up call from the Nintendo generation. We demand free access to data.
Fight the planet!
Copyright. It's not dope. It's not new. It's not sexy. It sucks.
Don't make me laugh. Your feeble plan to stop me has failed.
Okay, Doug. Whew, pretty good. And that happens to be like a 53-minute film. Not too shabby, insane amount of work, not only to cut the picture, by the way, for filmmakers out there, but to cut the audio too. In other words, the separate audio in a lot of cases under the picture. And insert stuff. I love that technique. And they practically invented it. It's not the kind of thing you learn in school. And not only that, but at the end of, say, 45 minutes of the 53, the last 8 minutes are the footnotes and the acknowledgments to all the sources of this thing. In other words, I don't do that. I couldn't do that. I try. But, really, that's keeping up with this, like an archival impulse I'm talking about. This, we made a new thing. It has a new message, yet it comes from X, Y, and Z, Elvis, of course. And, and so that's the astute, scholarly almost approach that these women take. Now, again, we're trying to get off of just my little world. We'll talk a little bit larger, about microcinemas generally. And, I'm going to name some of these places a couple times, so I'm sorry if I repeat myself. But, I've had shows at Project One, Southern Exposure, ARE, Club Commotion, The Offensive, Intersection, Club Generic, Somar's Gallery, and so on and so forth. That's just, whatever territory that I managed to race across. And they were microcinemas, and there still are. And I think it's actually growing, but it's a little bit different now. And there's a huge, of course, discussion about this in cinema culture. And it makes sense in the cities. Where real estate is so precious. But like I say, in the mission, there's an opposite impulse, and these new theaters are in place. And so because I think there's a kind of an audience there, maybe that's woken up to the richness of watching something on a large screen in a place like this, embodied with other people in the space, is a totally different experience. So I'm voting for that. so much for the microcinema, the human scale, the idea of embodiment and the presence of the maker and the audience together, and the ability to talk to each other. Like I say, there was kind of the idea of South America. I don't want to refer too much to the geography of San Francisco, which you guys might not be familiar with it, but a lot of that activity was in the South America, and it did kind of move to the mission, and we were definitely part of that. And the Live Workspaces tried to set up. ATA Gallery was actually a rehearsal space at one point. It was too big to live in. You only saw the tiny little gallery part of it. It's three stories. My basement archive is below, and there's people living above. See, that's the concept there. That allows us to pay our rent, see? So it's not like you sell the art on the walls. Galleries do that, but then you have to make a certain kind of art. How about a seascape? With some seagulls in it, and so on and so forth. Not to get into art criticism here, but it's just not what we think is what has to be produced or what we'd like to see on our walls. So it's not commercial art. It's art that hopefully, again, has a point of view and comes from the community. So Eyes of Hell, Anti-Film, Film Offensive. One of these I did with Jeffrey, by the way. These little projects that I had to develop this kind of repertoire of group shows, and also increasingly this idea of live AV. Okay, again, I don't want to go too much into cinema as an art form, but I'm telling you that because I think my theory is that because 16 millimeters, again, being marginalized, it can be sort of rescued or redeemed through a live AV. Of course, a lot of people do live AV with new media, sure, but film certainly looks good, and people just cannot get enough of the projector. Take my word for it. So when you that's something you can do in a micro cinema. Double projection or triple projection or some kind of performative thing or live music with projection. It's difficult to do like in a theater. Here it could be done, but they're not set up at the Roxy and so on and so forth. So it's kind of this mixing across of performance art with cinema now and media archaeology. All those things bound together, braided together in a live AV. We're leaning very heavily towards that, just so you know. Paracinema sometimes called. We call it optronica. I made that word up. So this lo-fi sci-fi is another one. Secret agents. I talked earlier about psychogeography. These are the categories that we sort of valorize and produce on our calendar. New experimental works, of course, is the consummating thing. But I'll tell you what. Here's a new experimental work. I hope you're ready, Doug. We're going to see Jeremy Warwick here did this about 1 month ago.
I do about once a week, you know, and then it's a screwdriver, open it up. But, you know, so they have to be in my archive. I mean, I'm very sympathetic with them. I lean in their direction. I want to love them. I certainly give them every chance to be appreciated. I lean in their direction. I want to love them. I lean in their direction. Their direction.
The day that sang and cried, the behavior of life between sail and satellite. Can I find something real to ride? Find something real to ride.
Stops abruptly. I'm sorry about that, but I'm telling you, genius or genius? Okay, that's everything I was talking about. This Jeremy work just nailed it. And I'm a little bit honored because, you know, the subject of that particular song, he did a whole 70 minutes, by the way, but, you know, there were several performances, songs, bits. Happened to be about my archive, and it turned out to be the finale of the deal. Just people went nuts. Well, they were already. But the absolute attention to the detail of the artifactualities, I call it, of material, and getting the titles and working out and singing the live performance in sync with four projections. So, you know, that's, it doesn't get any better as far as I'm concerned. So anyway, enough of ATA. Enough of the South America and the mission. I just kind of want to say, just give me 5 minutes to talk a little bit about the larger social history and why these things would even happen in the Bay Area. The kind of living legacy of large community, and by the way, very diverse. Not everybody agrees with me, but in case you notice. But the thing is, radical free thinking and stuff. And of course, you've heard this a million times about the Wild West and the Barbary Coast, and the city of pleasure, city valorizes a cultural the cultural life. The port city, not the Pacific Rim. People, place a destination. People come from all over the world, come here. On the other side of the continent from New York, not looking towards London, not looking towards the continent for ideological framework, but in fact looking south to Latin America and of course west to Asia, and that's the whole position of San Francisco. It produced this kind of very rich mixture and considerably diverse too, and it's as well as the tradition of course of gay and lesbian people. Let's say a Mecca, the world famous, and as you know it, and the women's movement and so on. That these political movements and ideas would have a ground here, fertile ground, and it's true. Despite all the naysaying that's coming out of my mouth, we step in as whether you know it or not, this living legacy. UCB is part of it, where my father went to school. My father grew up in Berkeley. I taught you, and so on and so forth. This is I claim it. You should too. It's mine. It's ours. And so I'm saying that this tradition, we're part of these deep threads of almost utopianism, generosity, kind of an idea of potlatch, if you know what that is, the so-called gifting and sharing economy, which, again, another word's been corrupted, in case you didn't know, and this idea of a consensus, democracy, these kinds of things, autonomous spaces, anti-institutional, even though I find myself in a big institution right now, but at least it's a nonprofit. But the thing is, kind of just small groups, minor cinemas, and so on and so forth, alternative spaces. That's really the theme of today's talk. In the post-war, there were rebellious youths. Maybe they were a little bit angry at what was going on, if you know this or not, Eisenhower years in the 50s. And this movement out of the cities to the suburbs, the building of the freeways, dependence and the centrality of cars, everyday life, everything, bad, the culture being destroyed of the urban areas. And so who came in there? Well, it's again, these kind of outliers. I'm trying to talk about the 50s and Jack Kerouac and Allen Ginsberg and the poets who came together, with the plastic artists, so-called fine artists. They didn't really mix. That's a generalization, of course, until the famous event at the Six Gallery, okay? I'm just letting you know, that's where it happened to be, where Allen Ginsberg read his poem. It was a howl poem. That was like a flashpoint, the trigger, where people finally got it, that they could, there was enough gravity heft to actually take a stand and kind of provide a kind of resistance. And so we honored Ginsberg, Kerouac, the subcultures of the Beats, but again, they were followed by other subcultures. The City Lights in San Francisco still exists. We honor that, or Lawrence Ferlinghetti, that tradition, though it's moved out of North Beach. And I mean, not the store, no, but the center of resistance, wherever, you could center it. But the thing is, the same thing happened over here with not just here, but of course, all these things happened in East Bay as well, and I'm sorry that I'm being kind of, chauvinistic by just talking about the San Francisco side of the Bay. I know it better, frankly. But here we had the free speech movement. Everywhere. But let's face it, it's right here. And whatever, 64, 65, Mario Zava, that is on the test. Now, Jeffrey told me that. So he got up on a police car or whatever and just started to rant and rave and speak the truth to power. So the free speech movement, the civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, the women's movement, gay liberation movement, yes, all part of this thing. Not that it wasn't happening in other cities, no. But there was something special about the Bay Area, that's for sure. I'm going to show you this piece, speaking of 60mm film, right now, that gives you a clue. 1962.
Hundreds arrived early at the City Hall for the hearings, announced as open to the public. The committee issues special white card passes to 100 of its supporters, each pass good for several persons. Committee investigator Wheeler says he issued the white cards to keep the communists from stacking the hearing room. The students protest they'd been lied to when they were told that the hearings would be open to the public. A noon rally is held in Union Square, at which 1,000 people hear Episcopal Canon Richard Byfield and California State Assemblyman Burton and O'Connell criticize the committee. The students who organized the rally set up a silent picket line outside City Hall. There are communists inside the hearing room, a small number of the witnesses being self-admitted members of the party.
Open the door! Open the door! Open the door!
They loudly complain that the committee has refused to consider their petition to open the doors to spectators on a first-come, first-served basis.
Open the doors! What are you afraid of? Open the doors! Here comes the goose squad! This is Americanism! What's this Americanism in action?
These communists, or communist pinkos, have to give their name and address, and that stamps them in the community. And it might be an interesting thing to note that if war ever comes out, ever comes forward, which we hope will never come, that different war veteran organizations, knowing these names, can strike the first blow at these people and finish them off before they can do any harm.
Friday, May 13th, the second day. This morning, the guards again let in the white card-holding guests of the committee. And once more, most of the people waiting in line are refused admission. During the noon recess, Sheriff Carberry tells them that their protest singing is disturbing the courts.
If you don't want us out here, are the white cards still going to be let in first?
My dear young lady, I explained yesterday and today as far as white cards. I knew nothing about it, did not know anything about it as far as I'm concerned. So people who are here will be admitted by the committee.
We shall cooperate with you until 2 o'clock. And if you keep your promise and let everybody go into that hall,
I promise you full cooperation.
If the law enforcement agencies do not cooperate with us, we do use our free assembly, our right to petition. We do it orderly, but we do it loudly.
Would you like to give us an opinion?
Those poor youngsters are brainwashed. They're absolutely brainwashed. I feel sorry for them. And there, some of them are nice-looking youngsters.
The students stop singing and line up outside the hearing room. The sheriff gets the committee to agree to admit people on a first-come, first-served basis. But the guards open the doors for the afternoon session and once again admit the white card holders first.
It looked as though if they had a little attention and some baths and their hair combed and some parental discipline, they might become good citizens.
Complaining that they have been deceived, they demonstrate loudly again.
A full-scale riot seems to be underway. Fire hoses.
Officers started the hosing, came across the barricade with their clubs out. Self was struck in the face.
Police are hauling out a bearded student, a woman. A woman is protesting, and they're dragging her out, too. The police have grabbed a Negro and are dragging him down the stairs on his back.
Mixed with the water on the floor of the City Hall.
No.
How old are you?
10.
You're 10. Were you in the rotunda when this happened?
Well, I was over there by the steps.
You were with your brother?
Most of the time.
And how old is he?
16.
And where is he now, do you know?
In Petty Wagon.
He was arrested?
Yeah.
Believe it or not, 1962. So, that's part of our tradition here. Just, it was a ridiculous idea, the House Un-American Activities Committee, and it was ultimately dissolved. And we did the right thing. We resisted it. You see, they wouldn't let the protesters in, and so on. It was denied their free speech and right to petition and protest and so on. So there's a kind of an example, but it was pre free speech, by the way. It's 62 movement, and you know, it's kind of a melding again the subculture and with the social movements in a way. You know, it's intertwining, it's braiding. It happened again, later in the 60s. Of course, I'm not going to go dredge through all this history. You probably heard it a million times, but it has to be acknowledged that Ken Kesey, who actually went to Stanford, is a writer whose films and books you've read and seen, I'm sure, had his little magic bus or whatever. Further, acid test, very important. It happened Longshoreman Hall, still there in San Francisco, and radicalized a whole generation of people. Traveled around the country in with his merry pranksters, and books came out of that. Electric Kool-Aid acid test, I think, by Tom Swarthout. Good read, you know, I'd recommend it in a second. And kind of this blossoming of this alternative culture that supposedly was just celebrated last summer, 50 years after the summer of love. Okay, well, so I'm not gonna discredit that. I'm gonna validate that. But again, 50 years later, it comes off as sort of a spectacle. Let's face it. And now the mood is can't be so utopian. It's again. I think the calls for critique. Negation, in fact. That's another situationist word, by the way. So then this, again, but blossoming of the culture, alternative culture of the 60s and 70s, and this counterculture idea, this group of intentional communities, this idea of affinity groups, communes, collectives, co-ops, group households, live workspaces, and now you're back to Craig Baldwin, see? These places that went down, I don't want to, again, list everything, but here, just a few. Project One, where I used to live, by the way. And there was Project Two. There's Project Arteau, which is still going on, and because they bought the building, in case you didn't know. You'll hear about Project Arteau, I'm sure. The Goodman Building changed to something, something ugly. Sears Building, still going on, where hundreds of artists live there. The American Can Company. Well, where Canyon Cinema, we'll touch on that later, was housed once, was a space. I shot a film in there, as a matter of fact. So we're taking advantage of these warehouses, lofts, attics, basements, barns, storefronts. They were available. Why? Okay, here's another kind of a deep, profound thing outside of the world of social practice, having to do with industry and the containerization. In case you didn't know, the San Francisco wharves and the piers there were once, of course, the destination. This is a very long story. I'll make it very short. For ships, but with the containers that you guys are used to, just so you know, because you're younger, they could be loaded directly onto trucks. You understand? There's no sense going in San Francisco when the stuff's going to Reno. So what happened was, in case you know, since you're living here, that Oakland became the port. You understand? Because you could put the container right on a truck, right out there. You know, the Oakland port, San Francisco ports changed to something else, like Pier 39, so on and so forth, or artist spaces. That's exactly my point. All the manufacturing spaces, small manufacturing warehouses in the South Market, became available because all that industry moved to the East Bay, you understand? And that's where, when we moved in. I mean, that's, again, a very generalized overstatement, but it's just largely true. These spaces were able to experiment. That's the theme of this class, is it? It's a place where you can experiment and not just live in an apartment. Not to put apartments down, no, but better if again, this idea I'm proposing is to have space to work. I'm just going to name a few. I already named, I think, the Angels of Light, or maybe I didn't, but where that used to rehearse in my space. The, of course, the Coquettes, let's not forget them. The San Francisco Mime Troupe that came out of the Diggers, if you remember them. That's also another one to look up. The Diggers, which, again, utopian, the sharing, the free store, pre-hippie. They left the hate when the hippies came in because they thought it was a commercialization of their ideas with the hippie tour buses and things like that. And they went into the country, back to the land, and started these communes all around California, Northern California. A huge, long story, and there's movies about that. Communes, a good one, by Jonathan Berman, by the way. Black Bear Ranch. The same thing happened up in North Bay, which I'm not talking too much about, by the way. You've got the Sausalito Houseboat Community, by the way, which is pretty teeny now, I'm telling you. Well, you think you can have a houseboat in Sausalito now? You know, there were pirate ships out there. You know, hundreds and hundreds of people in a whole community living, well, I guess you could say, offshore or whatever. You know, and the tremendous, again, utopian impulse and a communitarian impulse and a different style of life, I guess you could say. Not that I want to be nostalgic about it, no. I'm just saying that this is still in place. This Stuart Brand is, again, tip my hat to him, a guy who started the whole Earth catalog. In case you haven't seen that, it should be in the library. Should be part of your reader. The Whole Earth catalog. What does this have to do with art? I can hardly explain it right now. But it would new tools. Let's say new tools for a generation that was probably a little bit more technically inclined. This was 70s and 80s now. So the Whole Earth catalog, and then Cola Evolution Quarterly was another production of his. And so I'm only saying this, Stuart Brand happened to be in a live AV group. Little Pete, little do you know that before he started these very large, successful projects, he was doing stuff like Jeremy was doing. You know what I mean? Carrying around, I have footage of him carrying around 60mm projectors. You know, so that was the exploding, you know, plastic inevitable, the moment of media coming in the hands of artists and then creating this kind of idea of expanded cinema that I keep coming back to. So that's all sort of the North Bay. Here's kind of the listing part. By the way, we're going to see a film in a second. I just got to kind of get to these ideas of these spaces that were being set up. Not only in the North Bay and San Francisco, East Bay too, I was naming like these groups. Presidio Mural Project, fantastic. It still goes on, responsible for a lot of murals, you know, in the Mission. Did all the dance movement spaces. Well, that's this very contested area, because of course you have to have a lot of space to have a dance studio, right? When the first dot-com bubble came, that's where everybody was holed up in the dance space there, 22nd Mission or whatever, as of the last, like the Alamo or something, the real Alamo, yeah, hanging out and not wanting to give up that space. It ultimately was lost. That's just one example. Photo and print collectives, where silk screening could be done, and so on. It's Mission Graphica, then there was Gorilla Grotto, Suicide Club, Cacophony Society, the Museum of Conceptual Art, used to be above Breen's Bar on 3rd Street. Tremendous font of new kind of art, conceptual art of the 70s. A lot of it, generations coming from the San Francisco Art Institute. The Intersection, which is now shuttered. I'm sure they have their 501c3, but they don't have any brick and mortar. And you go up, you have to find it, not to put them down, you'd have to go up 3 floors to see their office. In other words, the huge activity, I did a show there, by the way, huge space, and now they got a tiny office, probably one person on, maybe on the payroll, and so on and so forth. It's sad. The farm down again. The guy who started it died, by the way, like 2 weeks ago. I'm not lying. All right, the optic nerve. That's what I have to do with Chip. Chip will bring this up. Optic nerve. I used to go to his studio. Ant farm. Another iteration of that earlier. Just required, no doubt about it. The guy's exactly what Jeffrey said. We're using new technology of television for artistic ends. Llama Mel, who could possibly remember that? Galleria del Raza, which still exists, by the way, on 24th Street. The guy also is ill. All right, the John Coltrane Church of John Coltrane on Turk Street. Just naming these, the Intersection, I just said that. Okay, Film Arts Foundation. Bye-bye. How many tears you want me to shed? A co-op where you can get access to film equipment and post-production flatbeds and cutting. And just absolutely the thing that this community needed, and fostering generations of good work. I worked there, I taught there, I got a grant for those guys. And I would go, and the guy next door in the editing suite was like Jay Rosenblatt. You know, I mean, I just, he was making films and I was making, and we had a community, you understand? Now everyone works at home. This is my lament, you know. You guys might not be in the whatever, the cinema world, but I'm telling you, everyone just working on their laptop. Well, of course that makes sense. I'm not saying it's not. It's just what's missing is this idea, is this exchange and embodiment again, when you get the people together, kind of more of the sharing thing. So, I'm still listening, you guys. So anyway, there's so many: Jetwave, Club Generic, Def Club, Club 9, A-Hole Gallery, Media Gallery, 80 Langdon Gallery, Oddball Cinema, Guy Just Died, Epicenter, Wearpad, Vortex, Counterpulse, Camerawork, Down. I don't know, they're probably down on the third floor somewhere down at the base of Mission Street. ATA, very few left, okay? Gray Area started, you might hear of that. Noise Bridge, Hackerspace, Dorkbot, those are cool, and we're glad to know they've opened up. The Internet Archive is, again, relatively new and very, very welcome here. We're coming to, there's going to be a rash of great films, so thanks for sitting through this listening of me, but I'm telling you, these are the kind of things that run through my head, my experience every day, so I'm the one to deliver. Of course, there's, like, just again, tipping my hat to the East Bay, La Peña, Escanats, 21 Grand, it's down, Cali Institute, Pro Arts, Black Hole Cinema, more or less down, the aggregate gallery, which is up, and the new Shapeshifters, which we love. And by the way, this whole speech is dedicated to the 36 people who died in the ghost ship fire. Just so you know, really down. No more. So, but we still contest it. That's what I'm saying. Stereotyping, fighting anti-corporate, you know, that's what it comes down to. And this tremendous influx of the so-called tech giants, and the Twitter, for example, and so on, and real estate speculation and gentrification in our neighborhood. So there's a new kind of culture war. That's kind of what I'm trying to talk about this whole time. Jeremy's was pretty good, but that remained within the art, cinema world. I'm talking a new kind of art work. It doesn't have to be, certainly not capital A, and a lot of this stuff is against high art, the culture of high art, even though, again, I'm in a museum. I'm saying there's activities at the edges and the peripheries. That's why I call my thing other cinema, you understand? This is a new way of performance. It's in the street, in fact. And I'm going to show you an example right now. It's a new kind of society of the spectacle. I think that's what's up right now. So version two of that society of the spectacle is talking about the loss of embodiment and this change in the vertical stuff. If you can possibly make sense of this very desperate. Okay,
right wing, left wing, we don't care as long as they're putting up their own message.
We are billboard and transit advertising company. We are the largest in the world. We have approximately 240,000 advertising faces in North America. We're in Canada and we're also in Mexico.
Yeah, we're not out to extinguish billboards.
No.
We're just out to make them more of a populist form.
Yes.
And allow more people access to something that, frankly, most people can't afford.
There's a new renaissance in outdoor advertising.
Right. They are everywhere, and they are in your face. And consequently, we believe that they're a common property. I mean, since they're ubiquitous, you simply can't avoid billboards. You might as well have fun with them. Well, we started in December of 1977, and we were inspired by another group, the San Francisco's.
Doug, I'm so sorry. Let me just play. I'm sorry, I've just talked too long. I'm very sorry. Let me play two things, okay? If you have to go, went through, you can. You know, we have 10 more minutes. I want to have Q&A. But let me just play. Can you play the bikes, not bombs thing? I'm very sorry. I lost track here. But you know, that was kind of the end of my lecture. Well, you, I set these things up for you, and I hope you can. I just get a glimmer. That was the Billboard Liberation Front. Fantastic people who were, taking their own space back. They're very famous, by the way. But go ahead and just play the bikes, not bombs. sorry, I'm a little bit out of order, but, you know, I'm emergency situation here. This is a pretty good piece here. This might be the last one. I hopefully we can get one more in. I want to have Q&A, that's for sure. And I'll be around here afterwards, by the way. You got to go to another class. So here comes Doug. He's good. This has to do with, just to give more context, the war in Iraq and unpopular war, in case you didn't know. And the people took to the streets in various ways. And in this case, it was devices. There are all sorts of critical mass. That happened to come from San Francisco, by the way. This bottle should be found. Got all these devices. Show because I've got to have some Q&A here, so I hope you like that one, because I do. So any questions?
Hi, thank you, that was so fun. You mentioned the lab, but are there any other places in the mission? You mentioned a lot of places, some of them are out of business, but if you could just name four places in the mission that are awesome to go to.
Oh, the well, like I say, you know, it's endangered. You know, it's like I say, a minority where it used to be. The lab is there. I hope I mentioned the lab, but I certainly intend to. By the way, the Redstone building is being sold. All right, so that was like a setup for a really bad joke. Yes, the lab is brilliant. We love the lab. It's a sister of ours. You know, there's our galleries around, but we're not just interested in again in selling. You know, what do you call artist commodity, you know. So I can't list all the galleries. I'm talking about it like an engaged space and body space. And so the lab and ATA are really the few I can name. The gray area, as I said, I don't want to make this a long answer. It has some good ideas. The idea is art and technology. So I think it kind of comes out of Silicon Valley or wealth from Silicon Valley. Maybe a patron who's enlightened who basically bought or rent the old Grand Theater. If you know all those theaters, talk about New York archaeology on this street and turn it into an arts and technology space. When I, in fact, did a show there. So that's good as far as what with this kind of new media we've been talking about a little bit and expanded cinema. That's another place. It's a little pricey, though, just so you know. But thanks for bringing up the lab.
I just wanted to say that I compiled a list of spaces that are still open today, which is in the file on the website, which includes many of the spaces that Craig is talking about. And so there are the websites for the spaces, and you can visit them. And as part of the visiting the assignment to visit three alternative spaces throughout the course of the semester, you can find many of these places that Craig's been alluding to. So there are many that are still going and going strong.
Yeah, Somar is another one, which is right under the freeway there. Galleria della Rosa that he sat on 24th Street is happy. There's some action on 24th Street.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I really enjoyed it. I was wondering that during your talk, you said that in the past there was a more like filmmaking. The community was more. It was a community, whereas nowadays everyone's slave to the device, as you said, and it's more individualistic, and everyone's on their laptop. So and I think we see that in the Bay Area as well because of Silicon Valley and all the changes. So as an artist, where do you see the future going, and how are artists combating this? And like, if you could, you know, advise us on as the new generation on how to combat this, and or how to balance out these two spheres.
I set up this kind of false dichotomy, false binary. I'm sorry. It's certainly it's not us versus them. I mean, that's what you're getting from me, you know, because I'm, like, again, a diehard. But that's a fantastic question, by the way. It's a genius question that is so genius that I couldn't possibly answer it. In other words, a whole class could be about that. But I think it's it hits the generational problem, if you're most of you are younger than me, that you kind of grew up with this, the idea of the this virtual world, you know, just everywhere penetrating us. And so you don't have to reject it, and I don't. Media archaeology understands not only whatever computer digital art, but also social media, larger web. Of course, it includes that. And the new media would be probably the answer to that. There's the so-called new art form. It used to be called internet art or something like that. They don't use that word anymore. There used to be divisions, like at the Walker Art Museum in Minnesota. If you know anything, one of the biggest in the country had like an internet art, quote unquote, where they would have art on the web. Well, that was an idea that came and went. But certainly, you know, you don't have to carry this idea of capital A art into the larger cyberspace. You know, you do with what you can. I do not reject it or refuse it. But I think you guys are developing your own art forms out of your own. Like Jim Campbell would be a perfect example of you know, using the new media in new ways. The idea has to do with creativity and innovation. You know what I mean? It's a different kind of tool, that's for sure. And also these cooperative efforts. I give you examples of what I call social media, that we're more, like I say, people in the streets, a little bit more performance art. But certainly it's true that new kinds of art forms are developing with digital. Certainly cinema has accommodated it, you know, there's more video shown than film now in theaters, you know. So that's an accommodation. But also the idea of interactivity and collectivity that's embodied in the whole idea of the internet is still possible, though, again, you don't have the presence you do with the kind of small group thing I'm arguing for. So it is another level, you can take it where you want with, again, the interactivity part or inviting the audience in, like museums now generally have some kind of interface where the people can work with the material rather than looking at a sculpture, as I said, a marble thing. It's mute, but here there's a kind of a talk back thing. So those are elements within the new media that allow for a different kind of art to develop. You know, that's kind of a quick answer. This performative thing sometimes is put together through social media. A lot of people communicate and get together. You know, what do you call it? Like a group, or you know, posting in a bulletin board. That's a great thing. Stuart Brand, by the way, practically started that in Sausalito with his idea of the well. And you should know that. You know, it's called the well. Now it's completely absorbed. But the idea, don't you see? That's my argument here. Is the stuff in the Way Bay? I know people in there. There's a ground for it. It doesn't drop from the sky. I'm going to do this. You know, no, it's part of the subcultures and the alternative spaces provided a context and a ground where the ideas trickle up. See, and so the perfect example would be the so-called mission school. I don't want to make this too long of an answer, but if you went to the Whitney. We're all talking about the Whitney here. Well, here's a bunch of guys, pals of mine, by the way. Graffiti, all the mural movement we talked about too, and painting on cardboard, painting on discarded materials, using tin cans, making sculpture out of junk. Well, hey, what's that sound like? Like everything I've been just talking about, you know, again, to redeem the residue left over by the military industrial complex. And in the streets of the city, putting their graffiti, and someone all of a sudden says, well, that happens to be brilliant, you know. We always knew it. And then next thing you know, Whitney, so-called mission school. So I'm proud. It's true. But it's just the idea that came, trickled up from the streets. So anyway, as far as the new media goes, I think there's ways and means. A lot of it is moving more towards performance and installation. You know, cinema's certainly there. That's my thing. But this idea of this kind of more... spread out a little bit from person to person, this idea of communication and transmission can be somehow rolled into the artwork. Any other questions, please? Yep. Good job.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah, so you talk quite a bit about the effect that like new media and the internet and things like that had on the art scene, and I was interested in what you think about the effect that like new filmmaking technology had on the, like, you know, on experimental filmmaking and peripheral filmmaking, maybe more general, because you've been in the scene for some time. And I'm thinking, for example, about like DSLR cameras. Do you think there's a good thing that, you know, those kind of technologies and high production value technologies become more available? Or do you think it's actually a bad thing because people now tend to aim for this kind of glossy cinematic aesthetic and don't go for like the rough edges anymore?
Genius question. Thanks for asking that. Again, 2 hours? You want 2 hour answer? That's fantastic. Here's a filmmaker here. All right. Again, I'm going to come off like a Luddite. My roommates have DSLRs. Yeah, I acknowledge DSLR. And the thing is, what they're really used for is documentary, just so you know. You're going to shoot. I don't think I'm going to take a 16mm camera out with a double system, you know, Nagra over here. No, they're fantastic for documentary. but that has to do with freshness and presence of someone you're following or interviewing. But in a lot of, it just kind of bears on my personal opinion. I don't personally like the look of, for example, I think they're improving look. Let's put it this way. I think it won't look so absolutely every detail and every such transparency and clarity that really, frankly, hurts my eyes. But I think people are going to get used to it. You know, I'm just an old codger, you know what I mean? And you know, like that great, for me, that film, that 60-millimeter film, City Hall, I just going nuts. I just love that. That's my generation. But if you guys want the glossy look, I mean, what I'm saying is I can hardly stop it. So I think that it's a good idea that there's new technologies to ease filmmaking. And documentary is a good example. But if you're making a feature, a narrative, or whatever, I don't think you have to, this is, well, what kind of, again, too long an answer. What kind of films is Hollywood making now? Well, they're making about a quarter of the films they were making 10 years ago, and that was a quarter of the films they were making 10 years before that. In other words, they're just producing less films and the more money per film, big budget. It's all about special effects, so-called blockbusters. So that's what the Hollywood has come to, the American film industry. Now, I'm generalizing. You're right, and there's a lot of good films that come out. But for the most part, the industry is centered on these big blockbusters that go to China, that go to Europe, you go to South America. It's all about foreign export of just to make money and rake in money. And it has nothing to do with the culture, you know, really what the discussion is here. It's a distraction. And I think a lot of that new media going into that kind of, you know, again, special effects is, you know, not worth a whole lot. But for an independent filmmaker, it's a little bit easier to make a film, I admit, but you have to buy the equipment, by the way, and probably a DSLR is way more expensive than a 60mm camera, probably. So, you know, it's not that we have two columns, you do the math part of it, but it's not necessarily cheaper, but you get a different look, and it's not fair to really for me to tell you, you know, what I prefer. It's certainly on the scene now, and I think people are just, they're gonna get used to it. And they think that's what cinema is supposed to look like. You know, that's why the importance of film history for that matter. But good question. Another one?
Hi. Thank you for your talk. I have a political question, kind of. So I'm trying to word this properly. Basically, you talked about spectacle, and you also use found footage and orphan footage. So like you're kind of at the intersection of cultural production and art. And I remember in that clip you showed in the French one, they use the term false consciousness. And that brings me to Marx, I guess. And I'm just wondering... If culture is mystification of reality, if you take those found pieces, is your goal to demystify, or is that a political goal, or is there just any goal to it?
You got it. It's, of course, it's a political goal. It's also an aesthetic goal, by the way. You know, I like it. It's just like rubbing. Rubbing together clay and paint, you know, rubbing together material, you know, which you get with 16. I'm not saying that everybody has to go that route. I'm just saying that here's one iteration where it can happen. It does happen. It's happens. Skoller was always the center of, and in fact, collage, found footage filmmaking. Bruce Conner, did he come up somehow? But yeah, what was my teacher, by the way? He had a gargantuan show at Museum of Art over there, in case you know. That doesn't make him good, by the way. No, that's the institutional thing I was critiquing. But, in other words, time had come, you know, and people all over the world recognized that this beats I keep talking about, the subculture, created this idea of the assemblage. He used to go out after midnight with backpacks. They called themselves the Rat Fink, some stupid name, a group of people. And what was happening at that time, I'll make this very short, where they were living in the Fillmore in the Western edition was we were knocking down those Victorians and displacing a lot of African-American families, one and two, building Japantown and so on and so forth. Well, all those things were going into the dumpster, the little bric-a-brac and the things that doodads, you don't see it here, it's all modern art, but the little Victorian things, basically. And that's, they were retrieving those things, just dumpster diving, exactly what I'm saying, 20 years earlier, and putting them together and creating an awesome lodge out. See, so it was, in fact, a kind of a sculpture. But in fact, his most famous movie, which is called A Movie, was originally part of an assemblage. In the middle of all these debris, he had a projector running, and it was showing a film, and it happened to be A movie, quote unquote, the one that he later took out and then, you know, was playing at the Walker or, you know, New York Museum, whatever, right now. So, pardon me? Okay, so you know, not to big deal about Connor. What I'm saying is Connor, you know, he's part of a cohort. He's quite a part of a generation. And that was a generation that went out and scavenged things from the, in that case, the Western tradition. That's where the Sixth Gallery was, by the way. The movement was a little bit farther north at that time, like, say, North Beach, but now it's in the South of Market. But anyway, I do think, and answer your question, which is fantastic again, yes, certainly it's political. I don't separate those things. That's kind of been the thesis here. So, it's not that everyone who makes a collage film, again, has to have radical historical conscience. No, that would be like a, you know, whatever you call it, absolutely restrictive, demanding, you know, and preposterous to do. That's just what I like, you know, and that's what we valorize at this gallery, but there's a trillion other galleries that do other things. Many, many, many more than ours. You know, so I'm not worried about dominating the conversation when you've got these romantic comedies and blockbusters, you know, two blocks away. So I do, one, like the idea of the collage, and it's not just a film collage. It could be collage that we saw John Hartfield, 20s and 30s, if you know anything about art history. That kind of photomontage and collage, I think it's interesting, fascinating. But what I really like is when Hartfield turned it into a protest against Hitler, if you know anything about that story. So it was great that he was making collage, and that became the art form of the 20th century. Again, I'm not making this up. You know, look at any history book. Why? Was it a conspiracy to make it? No, it was just the time when people picked up all the mass media materials all around them and put them together in a new thing. It just happened because a generation figured out that would be a wonderful thing to do. And also this idea that they were marginalized and they didn't really have money to buy new materials. You know, so like I say, turning the sort of liabilities and assets and using what was available. And so I love the aesthetic part. Yes, the sort of cognitive dissonance is created in collage, and the 1 + 1 = 3. I don't want to start this whole lecture, you know, where you have two elements and when you put them together and they're like each other, you have a third outcome. And this whole thing goes back to Soviet montage, and this is a huge, huge, huge discussion. It's great. So I love it in any way. But the thing is, while I'm doing it, it's almost already political, by the way, because of the nature of the ideological. The ideology is imprinted and embedded in the shot, see? And so when you see it out of context, it seems strange. You're what I call distanciation, back to Brecht. And you see, oh, well, that was just completely misogynist stuff there, you know, and so on and so forth. You can kind of reread it when it's put out of context. So it's political anyway, but I kind of lay it on thick in my own stuff because I try to lay the history on.
Well, with that, thank you. Yes, okay. Thank you.